Welcome to the CASS inaugural Professorial Lecture Series. This lecture series is an opportunity for us as a college to welcome new members of our professoriate. So I'm Anne Evans, I'm the Associate Dean of Research for CASS, and I'm delighted this afternoon to introduce Professor Denise Ferris. Denise is certainly not new to our college. She's been a photography lecturer since the late 80s and the head of the now School of Art and Design since 2013. During this time, Denise has led the school through many changes to curriculum, the establishment for the Centre for Art History and Art Theory, and repositioning the school and rebranding the school with the inclusion of design in its primary mission. Denise's photographs are held in many Australian public collections and in museums internationally. This record of leadership and scholarship has resulted in promotion to professor late last year. So congratulations, Denise. So today, Professor Ferris will introduce us to her photographic work and to the ideas and questions generated by her photographic practice.
Thank you, Anne. I also acknowledge and celebrate the First Australians and pay my respects to the elders of the Ngunnawal people, past and present. I am a photographer and my research is practice-led. As a researcher, I also write about representation, usually on the practice of other photographers and artists who have visualised the maternal relationship. I am an academic who advocates for the cultural sector and its associated disciplines. That advocacy brings both immense pleasure and predictable pain. At the centre of my visual art practice is the articulation of loss and losing. That isn't as sad as it sounds. The things you can't keep, the ephemeral, things that change, the weather, emotions, relationships, are potential grist for the loss mill. Remember though, for something to be a loss, it must matter. I'm interested in things that matter. Sometimes loss is also a simple human activity, and then that's sensitivity to change. I've explored losing or its sense of losing in myriad ways. As part of my doctoral research, making UV exposed casing photographs, milk prints, I visualised diverse aspects of the maternal relationship, examining connection, ambivalence, fragility in today's perspective on motherhood. You have to see my website, deniseferris.com, to look at those images and that whole set of research. We don't have time for that. I'm looking at one small section of my practice today. I do, as I said, continue to investigate photography's power in representation, focusing on a long maternal photographic lineage of amateur and professional intentions from the 19th century to recent photographs. This work, usually text, not image, continues to be important research to me, and I present that research at conferences and when I can publish. Amazingly though, I can trace my lines of thought and the logic of my research through all my work. The maternal, landscape, the land, snow, ocean, the transcendent and the real, the constructed and the realistic. And I hope to do this for you today. Once upon an island of white, an archive, my archive. Part elegy in the face of uncertainty, my work celebrates an island of snow already retreating. While photography is at core elegiac, as Susan Sontag notes, in this shrinking ecosystem, photographs of snow summon thoughts of a faltering climate. Capricious and uncontrollable, just looking at snow, we recognize a force that will be spent. In the contemporary world, depictions of snow or ice envisage future or imminent crisis. While my photographs describe a geographical and social locality, singular and unique, I broker an alliance with the oppositional aesthetic and conceptual properties of the natural and the constructed. An uneasy alliance and an uncertain future, I offer an account of place. This account is not summative, but builds possibilities with photographs as pieces of evidence, in series and in sets, not as one iconic image, but building and building. In this making and constructing ideas, worth is recorded and granted through the attention that I award the image. Perhaps more akin to the street photograph, these photographs are landscape of a kind, though not wild places, wilderness, or customary views, which picture the natural in the absence of the cultural. Here in Perish's Snowfield is a work of wild weather and of corporate instrumentality, of meteorological chance and opportunistic development, a fusion of monumentality and banality. My photographs lend aesthetic credence to the site of a resort's introduced manufactured infrastructure. Crucial to my intentions, the resort is photographed as a working landscape where labour and leisure actively exist clearly side by side. The human use of place emanates from the landscapes, not simply spaces for distanced viewing and observation, but places of human activity and joy. Through picturing the disparate engagements with this site of Perisher Valley, I claim a middle ground, I claim a shared space. Here I tread a conceptual fine line. While consciously evading the epic sublime of this transcendent landscape, snow, that is nature, intersects with a built environment, that is culture, offering a pictorial opportunity and also a potential aesthetic abyss in the contest between content and form. The mountain, of course, the ski resort, has traditionally epitomised the sublime as the monumental, but it is imposing weather in these photographs rather than an imposing mountain range that suggests the fearful sublime of monumental nature, capital N. An elemental force, unpredictable in its outcomes, here weather is essential to shifting experience and renewal. The national park itself is a cultural site, a modern urbanite phenomena, neither culture or nature, nowhere more so than in this alpine area. A national park which encircles ski resorts. All Australian ski resorts, of course, are in national parks. My aesthetic subjectivity and my belonging to this place is displayed. In their book, Landscape is Photograph, Jussum and Linquos-Cock discuss photographs as mighty indicators of cultural assumptions and note, and I quote, in landscape photography, implicit or explicit ideas about nature, art, and the practice of photography inextricably combine. The choice of scenes, the treatment of aspects of the phenomenological world as the source for images, the inclusion or exclusion of persons, the suppression of detail or the stress on pure form, the conscious or unconscious imitation of music or painting, the hard-edged fact of the diffuse visual poem, all are the outcomes in landscape photography of ideologies. Unquote. I could never reconcile my strongly held political and social views with the apparent benign beauty of my landscape photographs. But Gail Jones, the Australian writer, has a view that opens up a possibility, and she recognised this, and I quote, "For grounding aesthetic experience is a kind of political act and is having the potential to think about the past and future in different ways. Art is a resource for thinking and imagining different kinds of futures and for imagining the past that someone might carry," end of quote. Snow, of course, is the key, the core of my heart, to quote Dorothea McKellar. It is fundamental to the experience of land and to my enchantment with it. Pictorially, it is a unifying arena, the cold light of refinement, a world banished of colour, as David Batchelor in Chromophobia says, of the tomb-like current fascination for white. A white where the illusion of culture without corruption can be acted out as if it was real, he said. However, while I engage with the vision of snow as an experiential wonder, I'm mindful of its commodity status in a commercial snowfield. Coating the terrain, reductively icing a heavily utilised, groomed, conditioned landscape, snow serves as the common link between disparate interests, and snow is the mainstay of all social relations here. I want viewers to inhabit my awe, but observe the common ground and recognise their claim also to belonging to this place. The act of photographing reinforces my belonging. Robert Adams observes, we make pictures because of what stands in front of the camera, to honour what is greater and more interesting than we are. In return, we are giving something perfect, a sense of inclusion. Our subject thus redefines us and is part of the biography by which we want to be known. That definition impacts on my practice and what I want others to know. I establish an intermediate space of understanding through these photographs, not a visual archive of destruction, as Liz Wells observes is a familiar response to the consequences of human invasion on the landscape. Neither are they the heroic sublime of uncontaminated landscape. By integrating these dominant visual forces in my photographs, I forge a middle ground, which is most significantly not without power or without hope. Determined to demarcate a space in between extremes, I claim a version of this landscape through photographs as experience. And in the context of a large consumer enterprise, it remains a shared space. In claiming a middle space, I am unwilling to valorise the mountain itself as sublime or venerate the physicality required of skiing. It is part of my disavowal of interpretations traditional to sites such as the ski resort and the landscape mountain. Access to this snow experience and belonging to place is not the sole province of the mountain climber or the hardened adventurer. My work does not require a boy's own adventure, snow camping, or huge physical achievement. Big ordeals. While I cross-country ski around this pace and utilise the mountain, I photograph activities that claim the site for all comers to experience physical and emotional access to this place. In ski tracks adjacent to Norwegian cities, this series is called Navigations, my photographs reveal a sustained process of encounter and immersion, a material setting to transcend the ordinary, to move amongst the quietly magnificent. There, the phenomenon of snow evoking the sublime, not through grandeur, but through the expanse of emptiness. So this is a set where we look into this kind of sublime bracken, but we are also very much right next to an urban site where you actually literally get a tram to ski these places, which seem so remote. Or in the encounter with snow and in its ephemeral nature, joy and sadness. Navigations reveals our limitations in the face of weather and nature, where we are made vulnerable. In these close works, I still time and stretch time, expanding the space and positioning both the maker and the viewer as insignificant. In another series called Carbon Confessions, I collected airport floor plans from airline magazines and used them in a direct but enigmatic way. These plans outline public spaces, and while emblematic of air travel, they also suggest a subsequent footprint, and here an environmental footprint. At the draft stages of working with cutouts, line, fill spaces, scans, aerial views that all reference travelling, I layered terrain photographs of those floor plans along the tracks where I ski. My impact is represented here, my air and other travel, contributing to our planet's environmental changes and future challenges. These ubiquitous airport spaces, servicing entrance and exit, record my transit and expectations, of course, of my continuing global access. So another two series of work that I'm going to talk about here. Talk about some of the things that I've just discussed. This is part of a small series, nominally called Oceans, although most of my work doesn't tend to have titles. And again, it's about another kind of sublime immersion, I guess you would say. So another concern is also the issue of whether art and making art about so-called warming, about global climate, about change can actually alter things. So I read a paper that was at Land Dialogues, and some of the work here was in an exhibition. It was a refereed publication that's just been published, and it was called Beauty as a Warning. So a cautious, this is from an exhibition that Ruth Waller and I had in Taiwan, and this is just a bit quirky. This was a set of dancers who interpreted my work. You can see them in the space of some of my work. It was one of the strangest moments you will ever encounter. And they were a set of dancers. What was interesting about it, so they kind of did this dance, and you can see they were kind of ripping up the sort of ticker tape. And then the young woman got changed from a black costume into a white costume, and this was the end of the dance. And it was like, that is a very interesting cultural experience that we had. And so I had to put that in because I came across them when I was looking for images. Anyway, there were other amazing things about that cultural experience, like having big bouquets of flower that you got to wear and flowers at the entrance to the exhibition, etc., in exceptional hospitality in Taipei. Okay. So beauty is a warning. A cautious government estimate predicts Australia's ski areas could be completely bare of natural winter snow by 2050. The site of the original Kosciuszko Hotel, whose Grand Slam ski run was the first commercial ski slope in snowy mountains, rarely now has any snow cover at all. In this series of work, I utilise strategies necessary to undercut the viewer's expectations in the consumption of landscape photographs, and question how or if representation can provoke recognition of issues. I consider the tension between utilising landscape conventions in an alpine environment, let's face it, tricky, snow, think glitter, Christmas cards. And so I think about challenging those conventions while still towing that fine line and utilising them. So I think about the aesthetics of snow, the romantic sublime, of course, and I think about that in terms of bringing a focus to climate change. Every landscape reveals human actions and their values, and while my winter photographs manifest concern about this fragile climatic environment's sustainability, these photographs also significantly foreground human activity and pleasure. I visually broker an alliance with the oppositional aesthetic and conceptual properties of the natural and the constructed. The resort's use of snow as a commodity and the diverse human use of place emanate from my photographs as a shared emotional investment. Public depictions of this shared space are crucial, in my view, to the recognition of the extraordinary natural asset now significantly at high risk. Realising photographs of this astonishing, vanishing, and unstable landscape, my approach is to parlay beautiful but restrained photographs to deliver undesirable truths and considerations. Expecting to arouse feelings and to harness affect, my goal is refined environmental propaganda. So refined, in fact, I acknowledge that it can just go right over your head. Confronting our instinctive response to the traditions of landscape and beauty, can our consumption of aestheticized landscape be undercut to reveal some urgent realities? And that's without stacking a didactic slogan across it, without maybe with using titles, but without being deeply didactic, with just giving you the image to consider. Can the sublime aesthetic of snow and its aestheticized landforms be repurposed in their consumption and strategically utilized to address environmental urgencies? What Sontag does say, rather wisely in my view, is, I quote, "A work of art, so far as it is a work of art, cannot, whatever the artist's personal intention, advocate anything at all." End of quote. I tend to agree. it can't of in itself. But it can certainly make you think about the questions, as I said in my abstract that you read before coming to this talk. So another series of work, The Beautiful Failures of Photography, that I'll talk about, is called Celestial Spaces, where I actually take kind of representation's lack head on. The solo exhibition, Celestial Spaces, was shown in Pingyao, China, and in Kiandra, New South Wales, where the images were made. And this body of work addresses the missing narratives of the Chinese gold miners who lived and worked at Kiandra in the 1860s. In Celestial Spaces, 10 large-scale paired photographs consider photography's incapacity to offer significant understanding of the historical and social narratives of place. And I see this as photography's beautiful failure. The weather and the landscape are also introduced as characters in my account. In a broader identity context, Simon Pugh makes the point about landscape's symbolic uses, and I quote, "Landscape in recent years has stood as a surrogate for more politicized notions of nationhood, a displaced expression of sentiments of attachment which are denied expression elsewhere, and as a source of spiritual strength, a moral therapy," end of quote. You only have to think about the mining companies and the big expanses, center expanses, and a whole range of things. The landscape gets to sell our idea of nationhood quite strongly. The irony about Kiandra is it has a rather more complicated history. And there's a heroic history to Kiandra as well, where people went there and mined, but it was a rather more mixed ethnicity than is currently acknowledged. The landscape photographs of this series may be recognised as Australian and assume a coherent, uninterrupted Australian identity. However, this attribution of a sole hermetic identity is disrupted by the existence of the residual handmade landforms and discernible landmarkings pictured. So these creeks, some of those mounds that you see, are some of the things that you can see there. The foregrounds of the landscape images concentrate on sites that were the working and living spaces of Chinese miners in the 19th century. The material evidence pictured, the macro image you see, are the residue of objects touched and used by the miners in daily life. And these were excavated, in fact, from these sites by the archaeologists of ANU. The title Spaces suggests just that, gaps in our interpretation and only a semblance of knowledge acquired through all the accumulated evidence provided in the images. In the first photograph in each diptych are images of the sites where the miners worked. The partner photographs are the shards or sheds, depending on which discipline you come from, of ceramic bowls, cups, pipes and pots unearthed, as I said, over two digs by ANU students and staff. Two ways of looking, the view and the close-up, disparate perspectives through formally reconciled, in fact, essentially forced together. There's a mismatch in their content and formal continuity, a designed mismatch. The gap cannot be bridged through social knowledge that we currently have, and that knowledge holds only sparse recorded details of the daily lives of men who lived on these pictured sites. While my photographs acknowledge the Chinese miners' presence and contribution to Kiandra's place in history, these images display the photograph's ineffectiveness in the transmission of certain understandings. Photographs fail. The series outcome was evident when I was working with it. In that complex physical and historical landscape, the limits of photography to recount the biographies, histories, and narratives was clear. The work therefore drew on the attention, pointing attention to the limits of photography's capacity to go beyond acknowledgement, its inability to move to understanding without additional information. The series construction made clear this confounding misalignment. where it appears to formally come together but actually doesn't quite. The spaces in our knowledge. Questions, not answers, would be the staple feature of these photographs. Nevertheless, the joined photographs draw attention to the subject matter, bald and unexplained. Juxtaposed uncomfortably, these images still exist, I would say, suggest, argue, to raise awareness. In view of the efforts by this photographic series to represent absence with evidence, I considered how the photographs of celestial spaces really did foreground mostly, as I said, the failures of photography. The medium alerting us, in fact, to its own lack. This somewhat contradictory situation is that realistic landscapes and ceramic art evidence should offer more, rather than depict their own lack of capacity to deliver. While photographs are powerful, as we see, we acknowledge both their impact and their limitations in this series. They do not always hold the answers, but they're good, as I say, in posing questions. Celestial Spaces was published as a folio at the British Museum's Anthropology and Photography Conference, and it's also still on the RAI site as a pictorial research portfolio. I developed the research. I talked at the Labour Migration Conference and the Visible Evidence Conference and many others to attract Discovery Project collaborators. And in fact, we did put in a Discovery Project twice, written like in, I wouldn't say 5 minutes, but far too hastily. And I really hope that we can eventually get this up when there's some research time available, who knows, as a linkage grant. Still with collaborators from archaeology, one of whom is here today, and others from history and oral history, etc., across the college. So that would be really great, just that research time, whoever's out there. The last work that I'll talk about is actually published in a monograph, but published as text and with images. And I'm sort of going to quote for some of the text that I wrote, but it also comes from the site of Perisher Valley, but it was much more about a kind of personal connection to that place of pleasure and in an Australian snowfield. And it's called Conspicuous Consumption. Photographs of pleasure and loss, personal and public, in an Australian snowfield. The work examined the necessity and the implications of my ongoing motivation to photograph the winter and melt landscapes of Perisher. It's actually quite close to where I live when I don't live here. My continuing witness to this landscape and the land site is manifestly associated with concerns about the future of this fragile environment, an environment just formed by seasonal weather. However, the constancy of my interest in this site identifies my strong association with this place. The intensity of my rapt attention surveying the area like a flâneuse demonstrates the sense of belonging as well as a continuing search for resolution and definition. While these photographs are apparently cool and formal, there is an emotional pitch to these white landscapes and the affective manner in which white is parlayed. I've always considered snow as pure ground, a reductive swathe. However, I now envisage this homogeneous tone as a conspicuous trope that makes the landscapes open and accessible. This is, I see, an emotional accessibility, the openness of white. The landscape here is not merely a cipher for narrative, but rather intends to recreate the enthralled experience of the witness. So the few images that I've chosen from this monograph are kind of just emblematic of different groupings that we put those images on different pages under. These photographs are not constructed, but left completely unaltered, relayed as they were, as they are, the here and now, without sensationalism or extravagance. So my published text read in part. Pleasure. Quote Liz Wells, landscape real and imagined contributes to our sense of identity, subjectivity and collectivity. End of quote. Weather vane. So the winter landscapes of Perisher Valley, in the context of climate change, manifest concern. So as I said, my first intention is nominal environmental propaganda, a celebratory, if cautionary, tale about this site. But time haunts the series. The vision of this landscape itself, predicated on cycles and seasons, arcs of past to present, time running out and nostalgia, homesickness for a tentative future. Undercover. Moving decades ago from a city to Perisher, where fortuitously the one pub had an unused room, I set up a makeshift dark room. There I made sun prints, sardonically titling the series Mountains of Fun, which was the resort company, then a packer company actually, Kerry was still in residence then a packer company advertising slogan. It's now owned by an American company actually, Perisher Valley. The series used, that I made then, Mountains of Fun, used Aboriginal tribal maps of the mountains, explorers' diary extracts and scientific data with smaller scale images of vistas and views. Years later, I made Home Ground, landscapes about the same area. And in the article that I wrote for this monograph, I talked very much kind of about home and about finding a sense of home and where home tends to be and how you actually come to being, for example, when you're young, you can't wait to leave. I grew up in Brisbane. And at a certain point, I was pretty keen to get out of there. And I love going back there now. But when I came back from London, after living there for some years, I didn't resettle in Brisbane at the time. Again, I was young. Now I love going back there. It has no other kind of claim on me except that it is home. So in this series, I talk very much through the writing about finding home and coming to a resolution with the packer-owned resort that we all ski in. Tobogganers. Demarcating this place, I refuse photographic definitions that come about from dominant interests, the ski corporation or the state authority overseeing development. While this photography in Perisher Valley is not an overtly political act, it is informed by ideology, as I mentioned before with Jocelyn and Lindworth Koch article about ideology and landscape. Embodied understanding and critically, my belief in revealing the periphery as meaningful inform my photographs in between the land, landscape and its use. Just as citizenship is to be part of something larger, attached to a larger group by definition, whatever concept of the contested term citizen one subscribes to, if there are any sociologists here, belonging is in relation to a larger picture. That picture I've come to appreciate maps gender, class and equity, home where no factors isolate. My figures are Bruegel-like, representing everyone, but this fondness is not a feeling of pastoral reminiscence. These figures show the present and suggest the future necessity of social and ethnic diversity in this place. While snow is a commercial commodity, access beyond the resort is not currently user pays. So the tobogganers, the punters, as I call them, and are people who kind of get there and they have a crack at skiing and they do not pay an access fee to the resort. They just use it because it's there. My photographs value the current pluralism and portend a future when only certain privileged groups may be the consumers in this place. If there is no natural snow in Australia along the Island of Wight, access to commercially produced artificial snow will be very restricted. Only those who can afford to pay for admission to a ski field and its commerce will be participants on snow in Australia. I began with a sense of loss, indicating definitive transformation to the extent and appearance of snowfields through climate change. The value of accessibility to this place is both emotional and practical. Nurturing an effective relationship between users and place is crucial to caring about consequences. Building a shared emotional investment through images, which call attention to what we may lose and why we should care about what we may lose, is my abiding and paramount commitment in my work. So this segues beautifully into the other main strand of me that matters here. I am an educator. I realized this when I first began teaching and at the School of Art. I relish that experience, encountering so closely the aspirations of another. I thought, like you, my colleagues, that I could make a difference. When I became an associate dean, I saw I could have an effect on education and outside of face-to-face teaching. I wanted to change things, and then I wanted to change things for our sector. My desire to continue to make a difference has never wavered. Indeed, privileged to lead the school, it has found its home. The School of Art and Design offers and continues to offer a unique art and design education with strong interdisciplinary connections within ANU, direct partnerships with national cultural institutions, and sustained teaching and research partnerships in Asia, Canada, and the US. The school provides the public face, largely, of ANU, and that recognition, currently renewed, has positioned me to be an effective advocate internally and externally for the school and its associated disciplines. Moving across these fields, university, practitioner-based, and the public, is crucial to our strategic relationships and crucial to our success. Our connections have both felt influence, for sure, and had influence, for sure. Other disciplines want to collaborate, to use our teaching models, our expertise, and to share in our research. We have influenced other disciplines across campus. Practice-led research has gathered respect and greater understanding in most quarters. The School of Art and Design has an enhanced capacity to have meaningful collaboration with other disciplines. I do firmly believe this is important. Generating and maintaining networks and collaborations between the ANU, art makers, designers, organisations and institutions in significant strategic alliances at national and international levels does count. And of course, we are educators. And while some days it can feel fatiguing, we are intent on spreading our beliefs about the value of making and creativity, our beliefs about data and materials, and our beliefs about the value of history, theory, and publication. There has been a substantial growth in our school. Changes to curriculum, as Anne said generously before, and degree offerings. We've established innovations. We've addressed digital cultures and end user engagement. These new programs do expand who we are as a school, articulating with our traditional past as well as our transformation. A transformation which is to integrate highly relevant established practices, not to do away with them. It is a powerful encouragement to watch our school adapt flexibly to the challenging and ever-changing environments that we face, to respond to the sector's dynamic challenges in education and research. Breaking down discipline barriers and promoting the School of Art and Design sustainability, we do challenge and have challenged aspects of a traditional art culture. I make no apology. That is what artists have always done. They have challenged the status quo, and so it should be. We must examine and continue to examine things. Committed to innovation and growth, with the design degree, masters and other developments such as building the Centre for Art History and Art Theory, and Anne also mentioned, maintaining the health of all our disciplines, we have instigated a highly collegiate transition to a viable contemporary art and design school of the 21st century. And that is making a difference. Thank you.
Thanks, Denise, that was great. I'm always intrigued by looking at your work and the absolute whiteness and the sort of sublime whiteness, but the colour, you know, and I sort of look at the colour like there might be people in a ski thing or an orange fence or something, but then even the ones that don't have colour in, the white sort of becomes colour.
Yeah.
And I'd like you to talk about colour. Okay. There's something about colour that is in here.
Okay. Well, there's a whole series that wasn't in there called The Colour of Snow. And I suppose that white ground, it you know, it's a no-brainer, really. You don't have to be a good colourist, although I am very interested in colour, oddly enough. I'm interested in a kind of the subtleties of colour, I suppose. But against that ground, there are fairly evident things. You know, for example, in the Australian landscape, you get the kind of the khaki grass, and then you get that against white. Oh, to die for. You know, look, I have written about colour even with my K-seam work, which is white. It was super white when I first sort of discovered that as a process and made my milk prints, K-seam prints, white. They actually don't come out white traditionally, but I've got a kind of way to make them white. And the whites were of a different range. And I became really obsessed about this white, and I would pull them out of my darkroom and I would show my partner Ken, and he'd say, "Ah, they're disappearing." I was like, "You can't see what's in there." I'm like, "Good." And so they became, you know, they were really, really fragile, and they were meant to be. That was a series called Given Grace. And then the next series I made, I pumped up a certain chemical, secret, and they became beige, and that suited my schema well because it was called Home Decorum, and it was kind of about the tastefulness of beige and the kind of the holding the line, the domestic line in the home, and the tastefulness of, you know, not introducing any of those naughty, rude, not tasteful colours. And so that was kind of became beige. And I did a lecture here once, actually, about that work called Going Back and Going Beige. Anyway, and so I was pulling this fine line about the white, but always conscious of that colour, that really fine line. So the colours that pop in these, it's pretty easy to make a colour pop with a white ground like that, I suppose. But it's true, I am interested in the colour. And it, you know, what snow is, it's just frozen bits of water. And depending on the light coming through it, so really my colour that you see here is really not about colour, it's about light. And so everything for me is about light. And so the light comes through those little tiny frozen up bits, and it makes it green or blue or mauve. That's really hard to get rid of. Or, you know, all this sort of range of colours. And needless to say, I do really like to print my own work, or at least be very close to whoever's doing so, because I do that very fine line about what that colour is does matter to me. Which white is very important. You do not want to go to a paint shop with me. Does that help to answer your question? Thank you. Thank you. Helen Brand. I shall name all the questioners. Oh, no, maybe that's not a good idea.
You talked about how loss in one way or another is a running theme through your work. Is that something that you realised looking back over your body of work through the years, or is that something that was you consciously going to work thinking about?
No. That is something that it's a word that pulls a whole range of things together. But if I had to reduce it to that word, that's what I would say, and that's what I've just said. No, it's not something that I thought about. I mean, photography is lossy-lossy, right? I mean, you know, the minute you've taken, gone. So, like, you know, it's very different to a painting or a print, I would say, in that way. So you've got a bit of a head start there. but, you know, even in the constructed images I've made, you know, the milk prints are... they're made from a large contact negative in UV light, you know, very laborious. So they're not captured, as it were. So they're not captured of a moment and the moment's gone. They're actually made either by cutting out or other ways. And so they're not photographic in that same way, and yet I suggest they're still about something going missing, the ephemeral and all those kinds of things. So it sort of intrudes there. But I don't think at that time when I was making them, I was instinctively making them. And it's only in retrospect that you can, I think, really have a very strong idea about what you're doing. That's why the exegetical perspective on your work, you know, when you're younger, I think is so important. And I know it's hard and hurts, but... And I think I'd have to say I only started to see what I was doing when I did my doctoral work, when I had the time to really think about why I did the things I did and what really interested me. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Denise. That was terrific. You mentioned Bruegel, and I'm wondering if you're conscious of working in any particular traditions, either a photographic position or some other pictorial tradition, because there are a number of those images that for me sort of reminded me of paintings and things that I've looked at before, but also photography. I was looking quite recently at Frank Hurley's Antarctic photographs, and I'm wondering if your snow, in a sense, is talking to any other images of snow.
That is a really interesting question, Will, because... weirdly, I think I try and not take the kinds of photographs that others have taken snow, I suppose. And yet it's a bit difficult, given the content, it's a bit difficult to wildly escape. But I know what you mean. I think, for example, in earlier... I think in a way that I'm... careful of, I think my work's connected to pictorialism, and that can be a bit scary because it can sort of fall over the edge of, you know, pictorialism, you know, or the fuzzy wuzzy school of things, as the hard edge photographers called it. But I think it is connected to pictorialism. I think it's soft in some of those ways without being a sort of a soft, you know, lens. People are always telling me, it's a really beautiful, bright day. You know, you're going out skiing. And, you know, oh, it's really good for photography today. I'm thinking, nah, you know, leave the camera behind and I just go for a ski, yeah? There's no way in the world, yeah? But then the bad weather comes on, it's like, yeah. You know, my cameras are small enough that you can put them in warm places when you're skiing because, you know, obviously the digital cameras freeze instead of film cameras in the cold. So I think pictorialism, amazingly, and I think pictorialism connects my constructed work, the K-scene work, which you can all see on my website, and again, that fuzzy-wuzzy sort of school, which was, you know, just a bridge too far some years ago. But, you know, now, that's okay. So yes, I think, and I think sometimes I want to say hard things, but I'm very happy to say them in a soft way. And I took the image out, which was God Jule, which was, you know, happy, who can speak Norwegian, happy something, which was a little snow-covered, glittery kind of card that I put in this, because I think that tension with snow and sentimentality is a real fine line that you walk. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks, Denise. Could you say a little more about that Taiwan exhibition and the experience of the dancers?
I could keep you here all afternoon.
Did you set that up, or was it a spontaneous response by the...
The performers? It was... I hope I don't make you all ill by going back through this sort of like too fast. We didn't know it was going to happen. Ruth and I arrived at the opening and we had no idea. And then we were introduced to these young performers and at the opening. And there was this very formal opening and we were wearing our corsages. There was a four-piece traditional little orchestra, wasn't there? And speeches. And then... this started, we saw these young performers were introduced and then they sort of started doing this kind of performance and we were like, whoa. <It's> like, no one had a discussion with us. I certainly didn't set it up, I tell you what. It was kind of like, Ruth and I were just trying not to look at each other at the time, actually. We were just, wow, that's amazing. Because it's just something, it's something so unusual that would just never happen here. And it would certainly never happen without discussion with the artist, one. And also, we don't have a school of performing arts. I mean, but, you know, and for a whole range of other reasons, which I won't say on camera. But look, they were the most... But they were dead serious, as you can see. And kind of all... And the ticker tape stuff was kind of... I was like... trying to capture it was sort of flying around, wasn't it, Ruth? Can you? Yeah. Yeah. But the chain, then at the end, wow, that was like, holy smokes, what's going on here? I was reminded of, you know, going to art school in Sydney where you had performance nights. And, you know, mostly that meant people with their kit off, you know. And so I thought, uh-oh, whoa, here we go. And this is Taipei. No, surely that's not going to happen. I thought, any minute. Oh, wow. But that wasn't going to happen. And, and they were really intense and it was kind of in relation to this set of work. So I showed, we both showed a lot of work in that exhibition. And I showed, this is just one room. None of these images, these are actually Swiss. But, they decided to do it in there. It was really amazing.
Did they do one about Ruth's work?
No, Ruth got the orchestra, lucky old you. And I got the dancers in black and white, I know. And it was pretty, like it's just great. When I came upon them, I'm like, oh yeah, I'd forgotten all about that. It's kind of marvellous from a distance now. It was just a little bit unusual at the time. You know, it's a sort of a cultural, I nearly said bridge, but I mean divide, really, and sort of, you know, but as you know, those people are incredibly hospitable and just, you know, really go the whole hog, as you can see. Yeah, it's, and then sort of this standing up sort of, and there was a lot of kind of earnest, wasn't there, Ruth, a lot of earnest kind of looking and sort of giving the work the dignity that, oh, I don't know, it's like...
In the movement, were they actually addressing the photographs?
No, they weren't. They kind of live with them and then were sort of synthesizing their response, I think. No, they were kind of, in fact, they were keeping well away from, a few times they came awfully close to the photographs, didn't they? They moved around, they sort of were flung about quite a bit. And but they didn't directly go up to any individual image. They were sort of communicating with each other. Yeah.
There's no engagement with the work there, but
no, no. And I've just chosen, I mean, there were more of them from what I could, it's pretty low light, as you can see. But then they stood up against the photographs and did this amazing, but her changing from the black to the white was amazing. It was like, wow. Lovely, lovely young people. And very, very generous hosts, as you'd be aware. Hello, you. Oh, pardon me.
I don't know if you want to talk about something other than the dances, but...
I'll move to another image.
It's about your titles. You know, you seem very invested in the titles and that verbal aspect of your work. I just wondered if that's something that you've always done. You know, there seems to be a very strong poetic connection between the titles and the works themselves. Is that something that has always been present in your work, or is it something you've developed, you know, as you...
Yeah, I think it is something that that's always been present. I title a series. I never title an individual image. It's always untitled, which is hard for curators. Untitled 1, untitled 2, untitled, you know, up to 20. I think the names of things, you know, for me, they are important. You know, home decorum, you know, a work on the status quo. It's like starts to give you a kind of an indication of where we're going with this. You know, vestment, one of my casing series is a series of 5 images, large, and they are just a sort of a wrap sheet, but wrapped around different bodies of, you know, from birth to sort of death, I suppose. Vestment, so it's kind of this sacred kind of relationship, I suppose. So, yeah, they're a little bit, I certainly do want to suggest something in those titles. But I don't want to suggest that in each image. And again, saying that my account of whatever I'm trying to communicate is summative. So I'm building this kind of idea from a series of images, from a series of facts, if you like, or evidence, or and I guess the title kind of nails it. But I refuse to have each image. This is what this is of, you know. That for me is not how I want to nail it down. I want to nail down the idea, but I never want to nail down the image. If you can see that, that's a different thing. Yeah, that's very important. Thank you.
Thanks, Denise. Did you become interested in tracing these landscapes before you were concerned about climate change? And have you ever been, and or do you have any interest in going to Antarctica?
Yes. I'd love to go to Antarctica. I get really seasick, but I know you can fly there now, or very close to there. But yes, I'd love to go there, to answer the last one. And I've had an interest in this landscape since, as I said, I grew up in Brisbane. When I first went there when I was about 16, I have never forgotten the austere, treeless plain at the top of this Redbow chairlift. Never. And it's just a set of circumstances that I ended up living where I live when I don't live here. So the series that I've made, but they have nearly always, it's hardly ever been straight landscape. That set of images I made called Home Ground was the straightest black and white work. The National Park actually owns that now. That's probably the most straight, but they're not straight landscapes either. They're more details in the landscape. Before that, the brown prints I made that I talked about before called Mountains of Fun, they were, as I said, they took, you know, and Indigenous maps and other things and pulled them all together in these, again, printouts. They're not straight photographs. Like you take a photograph, they're a construction of photographs. It's a bit hard to explain. It's a contact process. But I made those, you know, the high country of Australia, and Kosciuszko in particular, is radically important to Aboriginal people. Like, it has a line from there to the middle of Australia. It is a very important place. It's a very important place, the Bundian Way, from there to the coast. And Aboriginal people have always come back and visited the high country. So I was sort of conscious of that when I first got there. I arrived in Perisher Valley from Johannesburg, actually, and to get a job for a while. And from going there, I've always been kind of interested in, first of all, the landscape, but not through landscape photography, but more about the kinds of ideas of what went on in that land use.